Zanicky, you have slept with Kylie Minogue on a plane, haven't you?
I just can't stop thinking about it, Michael. That's all.
I'm sorry.
Where are the roadies when you need them?
Yes.
There comes one. Come on, get in there.
Here.
You can say a lot of things about this show, but you can never question our professionalism. Just ignore Paul. He's on drugs. Back to me. I'm about to introduce our very special guest, but before I do, I just feel it's pertinent. It's pertinent at this point to pause just for a second for another very important message regarding safety when it comes to putting on pants.
Are you getting Jimmy's pants?
Yeah. For his missus. We should never have sent him up there. His tackle meshes weren't checked out. There was no protective buttons, zippers. The pants were just too tight. What did he expect?
I can still hear Jimmy screaming as he fell.
Yeah, we all can, right? We all can.
Pants cover safety. Think it, talk it, wear it.
It's all a bit somber, so let's pick the mood up just a tad with one of this country's, well, most famous authors and also one of this country's most prolific. She's out here at the moment to take part in the Melbourne Writers' Week. Make her welcome. It's Kathy Lett. How are you, Kat?
G'day.
Pleasure to have you on board. How's it going? You've started at the Writers' Festival.
It's very suave. I'm trying to get in touch with my inner adult.
Your inner adult?
Yeah. I've been hooked up, intravenously to a thesaurus all day, which is why I'm in my pinstripe suit. I'm a bit suave.
You're looking
you
very
gosh. Though. Look at you.
What are you talking about?
It's like suave city.
I told
look.
You to make an effort. Yeah. I'm great.
I'm dressed by Target.
Yeah, I was going to say, whoever makes your clothes is too embarrassed to sign them, you know?
Hey. You're not in London high society now, Kathy Lett. Welcome home.
Oh, it's bad.
Welcome home. You're in a great position to see what's happening in Australia from the third person. Mm. Is it 11 years you've been living in Britain?
Yeah. Well, living in Britain's a contradiction in terms. You just sort of survive there because they're very, very weird people.
Okay,
you
get by. But coming back, do you notice changes in this country?
Well, the men, they used to be Neanderthal when I lived here. They sort of disproved the theory of evolution. They were evolving into apes. But now they're doing sensitive things with snow peas.
Look at that. We're modern new age guys. We're into things. Schwai and all that crap.
So that's one thing that's improved. But you've got to become a republic. I mean, that's really embarrassing.
Are they talking about that overseas?
Well, the British see Australia as a recessive gene. We're kind of the Irish of the Pacific. Right. That's how they see us.
Yeah, sure.
You know, and who wants to have any allegiance to them? I mean, the royal family are just the winners in the lucky sperm competition, aren't they? Really?
Exactly.
And, absolutely. You know, if you talk to most Australian kids about the Queen, they think you're talking about Elton John. I mean, so please, let's lighten up.
And you wouldn't be far wrong. But even it seems to me that even the British royal family don't seem to give a toss whether we were becoming a republic or not. They seem pretty non-committal about it, don't they?
Yeah, no, what do they care? Oh, weren't you appalled about Sophie Rees-Jones, saying she was going to obey? Could you believe that? 90 years since Emily Pankhurst tied herself to the railings. Yes. I mean, only dogs hear when called. She's probably going to start sticking her head out the royal car window or something, Just the pits. I mean, what kind of people are they?
Did that cause an outrage? Was there much talk about that?
No, well, England's very post-feminist. I mean, I think anyone who calls herself a post-feminist has kept her wonder bra and burnt her brains, Because you boys, for some reason, are still ruling the world. I don't know why, but you are. But no, they're very...
You'll get used to it eventually.
Dream on. Dream on, boy.
Hey, look, in a lot of your novels and in a lot of your films, a lot of the gender relationships come up a lot, but you don't have a bad take on men. Generally, though, do you? I know you have problems with them, but a lot of the heroines of your pieces aren't disinterested in men.
Well, if only there was a third sex available to us. That's the only problem.
If you have a look over here, I think we might have solved your problem, Kathy.
Is he animal, vegetable, mineral? I'm not quite sure.
I'm not sure.
No, not until you tried it, baby.
Dear, oh dear.
Well, look, in the new book, I've done alter ego. I mean, that's really an antidote.
Here it is.
To...
Here, could I just push that, put that up quickly? That's you need to get a look at
thank
that.
Thank you, oh, book plug.
Tell,
that's
tell
what
us
I like.
A little bit about
well,
this.
Well, it's a kind of antidote to this notion that women are nothing without a knight in shining Armani. You know, we're nothing without a fella. Because you know, girls, you're supposed to turn 30, and suddenly you know, when the snooze alarm goes off on your biological clock, and suddenly you're no longer looking for Mr. Right, but Mr. Kind of Okay, Mr. Vaguely Bearable, Mr. Two Corpses Short of a Serial Killer. Well, you know,
I'm putting my hand up. That's me.
I'm right here for you, baby.
You know, but it's all rubbish because the truth is, you know, now that we're economically independent, we can impregnate ourselves. Mm-hmm. I mean, if our vibrators could kill spiders in the bathtub, bite the Barbie, kiss our upper eyelids, and tell us we don't look fat and stretch lycra, would we need you at all?
No! No! But you'd miss us after a while. Yeah, I would.
But I don't know, you know, the minimal acceptable hideous habit ratio between spouses is about 100 to 1 in the man's favour.
Yeah.
You pee on the porcelain.
Sure.
What is that?
It's on my resume.
Yeah. Post-urinal drip syndrome. I mean, you fiddle with a fridge thermostat for fun. Oh, air guitar. Pet names for the penis. What is that about?
Hey. You know? Not in front of Oscar. All right. That's enough now. That's enough.
Yeah. Paging Dr. Freud to reception.
Yeah. Big Steve's getting upset.
There you go. Hey, so, you're out here now. Can would you mind? I mean, I know you're probably way over it, but when we heard you were coming on, we're all having a yak around the office about Puberty Blues, which is a great...
God.
It's a seminal Australian film, and hasn't it stood the test of time? It's like even... at the can I ask you at the time, did it get critically panned, or how was it received critically at the time?
Oh, I think it was critically
panned. It was panned?
Yeah,
do you think
course.
That's a kind of snobbery that's... because it's comedy or in a comedy genre that as a first port of call,
well,
it's disregarded?
There's this great myth that women aren't funny. I mean, I think it is because men are terrified what it is we're being funny about. I think they think we spend the entire time talking about the length of your penises, which is not true, because we also talk about the width, which after childbirth is much, much more important.
Okay.
You know? So, I mean, male critics always pan women who are trying to, you know...
That's when I get together with my mates, that's what we talk about too.
Width, yeah. Oh, there you go. But small talk.
Yeah. Dave. Teach you to chime in. So we were talking about Puberty Blues, and there was one scene that we all remembered right off the bat as a bit of a classic. Do you mind if we found a dodgy old video copy
out?
Let's
have a squeeze.
Let's just have a look at Puberty Blues.
You weren't watching.
I was.
Caught this really good wave. I looked up and you weren't watching.
I was. I saw you.
Yeah, she was.
Where's my towel?
Here. Here's your towel. Want a smoke?
Yeah.
Where's me smokes? Did you see that big one? That's
Yeah.
I've got them. Here they are.
Geez, I'm hungry.
I'll get you something. What do you want?
Chico roll.
Give us a match.
And a chocolate thick shake.
No, thanks. Okay. Anyone else want anything? No, thanks.
Oh, yeah. Get us two Dim Sims and a can of Coke. Thanks.
Geez,
girls never ate in front of their boyfriends.
Yeah.
It was unladylike to open your mouth and shove something in it.
I'll play back later, all right?
Okay.
We were also busting to go to the lavatory. But that was too rude for girls. Our stomachs rumbled and our bladders burst.
Oh, yeah, and don't forget the sauce. And don't take any bites of it on the way back, all right?
Isn't this great?
Yeah.
That's the kicker.
Right.
Can you believe it? But you know, these guys were so Neanderthal, these waxhair guys. Mm. The most sexy
thing. So you were a bit of a surfy chick yourself. We should point this out. This is all from experience.
Oh, yeah. I went out with all those guys who thought sex drive meant doing it in the panel van, you know, in the car.
Sure.
That raised some very important issues, didn't it? Like, whatever happened to Chico Roll?
But they...
Dave, you're not helping.
But they were so sexist. I mean, women had to live vicariously through these guys. Mm. And, for example, they used to get us to cut their names out in paper.
Now, this is a great story. Can
and
you tell
true.
Me this? This makes me laugh.
They used to get us to cut their names out in paper, sticky tape them to our stomachs, and then sunbake so we get a tan tattoo in the shape of their names. So if I ever get cancer, I'm going to have a melanoma called Bruce. I'm going to have a brucectomy or something.
Do you know, I'd love to see you, Kathy, coming off the beach sometime next week with Jeffrey Robertson QC. sunbaked into your stomach. Because that's your current bow, isn't it?
Yeah, I'm going for gold in the Hypocrisy Olympics because I slag off marriage and all that sort of stuff, but I am quite kind of happily married. But there's some good things about being married. I mean, the relief of not having to get naked in front of a stranger ever again. Yes. You know, not having to lie on your side in bed to make your breasts look bigger all the time. That's quite good.
I have that problem.
You have that problem, yeah.
I'm trying to reduce them.
I love that breast reduction. It's like, aren't two the normal amount? Yeah, go on.
Hey, now, Jeffrey, he's out here too for Writers Week?
Yeah.
Is that right? He's delivering a keynote speech sometime this week.
How's he
going? What's it like living with Mr. Goody Two Shoes? Mr. Human Rights Lawyer? Because you've got a weird one there. You've snaffled a lawyer with integrity. How the hell did that happen?
Is that? I know.
What's the deal?
But I have to say, it's a pain being married to a human rights lawyer too, because you can never get the high moral ground. You know, when I say, come in here and change this nappy, and he says, I have 350 people on death row in Trinidad. What am I going to say? I don't care. Although, after about a year, I'd be saying, oh, let them die. You know? And a year later, I'd say, I'm going to go there and kill them myself. You know? So,
fantastic.
But he is good.
Fantastic. Yeah. And you mix with a pretty high, fast crowd in London town. Yeah. Do you know the Blairs quite well, the current British PM? How are they? Are they nice people?
Yeah, they're fun.
Oh, really? Because does he ever drop that kind of public school debating persona that we see so often in his speeches?
Look, what's really nice about him, well, first of all, how rare to have a politician who cares for more than just the size of his election, you know. He's really passionate about his politics,
sure,
which is pretty good.
That's true.
But also, you know, in England, so many POMs have graduated from Oxford in advanced condescension. They have a condescension chromosome, you know.
Yes.
They're kind of Conan the Grammarians, always correcting your grammar and stuff. And he's the opposite of that. He's really friendly and lovely. No, he's good.
That's fantastic. And how are you accepted over there now? Because I know when you got there initially, a few people took umbrage. Because you didn't I think you cut the lunch of the daughter of the Chancellor of the Exchequer there at one stage.
That's
when you
true.
Took up with Geoffrey Robertson.
Well, Jeff was going out with her, yes. Mm. So the gossip columns had a field there. They kept saying, how could good-looking, gorgeous, talented QC dump, you know, good-looking, gorgeous, talented daughter of someone very, very famous for loudmouth colonial nymphomaniac? And I'm like, how dare they call me a loudmouth, you know? So upset about that.
Look, Kathy, we've got to wind up now, but look, I want to mention your new book again, Alter Ego.
What
which
a
guy. How's your husband go with the subject matter of this? Because it's pretty much kind of doing the dirty on someone pretty similar to your husband.
In the book, she runs her out on a human rights lawyer for a, you know, hot to trot stud muffin black rock star. Mm. But Jeff says that the hot to trot stud muffin black rock star is based on him.
Yeah. Okay, and just before we go, have you ever had sex with Kylie on a plane?
No, but I do know the rules for the Mile High Club.
Oh,
someone new, not the crew, and not in the loo.
I'm writing that down. And I think that makes you ineligible.
We could join the Foot High Club right now.
Kathy, if this couch folded out into a bed, I'd jump your bones. That is my pledge to you. We'll be back in a minute. Thank Kathy Lett for coming by. You're a champion. We appreciate it. We'll be back with more in a minute. Melbourne Writers Week. Get down there.
Honey, your breakfast is ready. Will you be long?
Won't be a sec, love. Just putting my pants on.
No!
Pull your pants up and live.
You're laughing now. But pay attention, it could save your life.
You're right there, son.
All right. Welcome back. Hey, there's been a bit of mail this week regarding our good buddy Mini Mick. You know, you're still on speaking terms. Yeah, you still hang out together, that kind of gear. And the short answer, of course, is yes. And in fact, only this week, we kind of like to do it every week, me and Mini Mick decided to get in the car, Mini Mick's car, and head out cruising. Check it out. All right then, Mini Mick, let's hit the road, eh?
Let's go, let's rock and roll.
All right. Let's rustle up some fun, eh?
Not that one, it is. Get in here.
Oh, sorry.
Okay. No, let's go.
Oh, hang on a second, just before we go. Have you got a license?
That's right.
Come on. Don't trust you. Oh, yeah, I suppose that should be you. You haven't been drinking, have you?
Nah, not yet.
You feel like one?
All right, I wouldn't mind. Let's go.
All right. All right, Minnie Mick, I'll do the ordering.
Okay, mate, just the usual, thanks.
One for me. And one for you.
Okay.
See you, buddy.
Hey, Minnie Mick, feel like going to the cinemas?
Yeah, what's on?
Eyes wide shut.
Okay, let's go.
Yeah, see if we can sneak you in for a concession.
Come on.
Why do we have to leave so early?
Minnie Mick, you know you have to leave after the shorts.
Oh, get stuffed.
No, you get stuffed.
No, you get stuffed.
Jeez, you're cheeky.
Haven't started yet.
Oh, come on, mate. Oh, come on, look, he's trying. Oh, I can't believe those arseholes. When are paying that?
No way, we'll take him to court.
Yeah, we'll take him to the small claims tribunal.
Hey.
Oh, it's just a joke. We're humble now. Minnie Mick, I think we might be in, sunshine. All over. Hello, ladies. Looking for a good time? Get in. So, how's this weather? Maybe we should head down the beach, eh? That's why we left manpower. In the end, it just got a bit boring. You know what I mean? All righty.
All right.
Come on.
You get a bit teary watching that, Bob. It's one of the best days of my life.
It's understandable.
It's understandable. Enough of our hoo-ha. Hey, we got the satellite in position, Arch. We're ready to go. Because we're going to attempt another cross to Edinburgh, where our good friend Judith Lucy is currently wowing about the festival. Jude, come in if you can hear me.
How are you, Mick?
Jude, where the hell have you been?
Well, it's official. I've joined the cast of Cats.
Okay.
Now, I tell you where I have been.
Yes.
I've been to a street market.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
And what I love about travelling is that it really does help you realise the things that are universal. Mm. For instance, I have become convinced that no matter where you are in the world, show me a dickhead who's willing to put his head into a bath full of urine for the sake of a free beer, and I'll show you an engineering student.
Oh, dear.
And in a similar way, no matter where you travel in the world, street markets are shit. They sell the same things everywhere. It's the same silver jewellery. It's the same clothes you would only wear if you were friendless and blind. And always just so many candles and so much leather, not even the Catholic Church could get through it all. Oops, vicar. But now, one of the things I had done was I had my portrait done.
Oh, yeah.
Can we see that? Because, look, I would get the camera person to actually move the camera, but Tony, Richard and I are just sitting in a room on our own with a camera hanging out of a wall. There is no camera person. The ABC might be complaining about cuts, but I'm telling you, at least their crew isn't being replaced by bricks. But anyway, back to the portrait. Now, I reckon I look a bit odd. Tony's helping me here. There you go, that's Tony Martin's hand. I reckon I look like the Joker from the Batman movie if he were a girl and, let's be frank, deformed. I mean, why is my head bigger than my torso? I look like I'm some sort of victim of chemical warfare.
You know what it looks like to me,
Jude? I bought you a little...
It looks to me like a courtroom artist's impression of a trial involving Princess Margaret.
Well, now that you've said that, Mick, I'm very happy that I've picked you up a little present.
Oh, dear.
Because I bought you this. And you're probably thinking, why is Judith spending money on a stick? But it's so much more than that. Mind you, I'm sure that people have sold sticks at street markets. They've probably just popped googly eyes on them and gone, look, it's a pet. It's a crazy stick. But no, it's actually a pencil.
Get
out of here. What an incredible idea. I mean, you know, I reckon if someone gave you this, you'd just go, look, there's only one thing worse than this, and then you'd sharpen it and poke it in their eye. But no, there's more fun. For an extra 50p, I don't know if you'll be able to make this out, Mick, but I had it personalised with your name on it. Because you wouldn't want this falling into the wrong hands. And I actually wanted him to write Mick Molloy, but he said, despite the fact that he was just stamping the letters on with a rubber stamp, he's gone, no, six letters is my limit. So, you know, I guess if your name's Roberta, you're screwed, but let's face it, if your name's Roberta, you're probably a bit screwed anyway. Now,
yeah.
Two plastic bits of crap? No, jewellery. Apparently, this is a bracelet. And this is a necklace.
Mm.
So I'm just going to start getting some discarded bits of dental floss and turning it into earrings. Here we have something that's a little reminiscent of the copper tongue scraper I showed you a few weeks back. It's the orgasmatron.
Hello.
Now, fortunately, this isn't meant to go anywhere near your genitals. Apparently, this is what you're supposed to do with it. Orgasmatron, well, boy, I've always gotten off by scratching my head with a rake. And I tell you what, Mick, show me a street performer in this country and I'll show you a person wearing one of these.
Ah, yes.
Apparently from Peru, which is where I'd like to send most of the street performers I've encountered. But, you know, for God's sake, is that doing anyone any favours? I mean, why would you go out wearing a tea cosy? You may as well just pop a thermos on your head. But I will tell you about the best street performer I've encountered so far. His name is Mystico.
Yeah.
He gets around in a pair of filthy jeans, a filthy wind cheater. He seems to have a bit of vacuum hosing attached to his chest. He's got antenna. And the one part of his costume that I do understand, a mask, he's obviously meant to be an alien.
Yes.
And his act consists of, I'm not kidding, he just runs up to people in the street and exhales. He's obviously trying to do some Darth Vader thing. And I was just standing there thinking, I meant to give you money for breathing. Well, I might give you money if you stop.
You, Jude, are a nightmare. Now, tell me this too. I believe during the week you had your tarot cards read, is that true?
Oh, I did. Look, I had that done at the market as well because, you know, no trip to the market's complete without a really crap reading. And this woman told me that apparently I'm actually receiving a lot of love at the moment from animals in the universe, especially, of course, dolphins.
Right.
And I did feel like saying to her, well, look, the only contact I've had with dolphins, it's been when I bought some tins of tuna that haven't been too friendly. And, you know, I just thought, golly, all these years trying to meet people in bars, I should have been hanging out at SeaWorld. And then she told me... Then she actually told me that dolphins communicate through vibrations and so do humans. And then she said, you're making your own dolphin noises right now. Which is when I wanted to say, well, Dr. Doolittle, do you know what I'm saying? You're a raving lunatic. But, you know, then I went home and cracked Flipper up with that story for hours.
Absolutely.
And then finally she said to me, you know, there's a lot we can learn from dolphins. And she said, we can learn a lot from the way they breathe. And then she said, if you ever have any kind of brain problem, and I thought, well, at last, a topic you're probably qualified to speak about. And she said, if you ever have any depression or anxiety, you can cure it by simply blowing your nose.
Dear, oh dear.
So, I don't know if you've noticed, but I've actually come down with quite a bad head cold, and I was a bit put out by that, but now I've realised it's really just a fantastic opportunity for me to really come to grips with being adopted.
Oh, that's fantastic. You've made a breakthrough there, Jude. I'm going to have to...
I know I have.
I'm going to have to wind it up there, but tell that Tony Martin not to go away, because we'd love a quick word with him as soon as we get back from the break. And just before we go, Bob, do you have a question?
Judith. Bob Franklin, Channel 9. Jude, I saw a postcard the other day and in it the Loch Ness Monster had a kilt on and some sort of Scottish hat and he was chatting to locals in a Scottish bar. Is this a regular occurrence or was that just a sort of jokey postcard?
Yes, it is. He's a very friendly monster, and we're actually going out for a drink tonight.
All right. Good well, news. Make sure you keep that hat on, Jude, and you'll have no problems whatsoever.
Bet.
We're going to take a break. Thank you very much, everyone. Thank you, Jude Lacey, absolute champion, taking time out of a very successful Edinburgh show to talk the breeze with us. We'll be back after a short message with Tony Martin. Don't go away. I'm going to have to ask you to keep punching 20s into that satellite feed because we need the line just a little bit longer to check in with our good buddy, Tony Martin. Are you there, Tone?
Oh, yeah, you've got to get one of these. It's fantastic.
Oh, I'm glad I'm not wearing tracky
days. So it's probably a bit blue for this title.
Yeah. How's it
not
going?
Not too bad, Mick.
12,000 miles.
Not bad. I understand that there's a bit of a delay.
Same joke twice. But
value for money.
What's happening?
Look, I'm told, is there a bit of a delay between when you say something and I respond? If so, I think those gaps would be a good time for people to maybe just pop out and make a coffee. I'll do that.
I think there's plenty
and,
of time.
You'll notice... can you see what I'm wearing here? I've got the Martin tartan on. And I've been wearing this jacket all week, but it turned a bit weird after Wednesday when they arrested that bloke from the Bay City Rollers.
Oh, they arrested the bloke from the Bay City Rollers? What for?
Yeah. The entire back catalogue, I think. Finally caught up with him.
But, fantastic.
Listen, I have been out on the streets all week talking to the locals. I've been asking them about their food because, really, I think they owe us some kind of explanation. And also, did you hear about that poll here in Edinburgh? Well, it was a worldwide poll to find the sexiest man of the century.
That's right.
And they went with Sean Connery,
yes.
Who, of course, is the big man here in Edinburgh.
Mm-hmm.
Not Reethy. Surprisingly. And I figured after those... we saw those photos you were showing last week.
Yes.
Very nice stuff. But, look, I've been talking to people in the street and I think you've got some footage at your end. Here's what happened.
Madam, we're from Australia and we've heard that Sean Connery is the sexiest man of the century. Would you agree with that?
Heartily, yes. He's wonderful.
And you do a Sean Connery?
No, I can't. Well, apart from going to Spain and, you know, speaking Spanish and things like that.
He's turning to history.
Good God! Sexiest man of the century. Who is the sexiest man of the century?
I've yet to meet him, son. It's not you.
What about... who is the sexiest man of the century, madam?
That wee man will be a crusader, see him?
Which one there?
The wee one.
Get a shot of him, Ruth. That is the sexiest man of the century.
Yes, definitely.
That's Stephen Hawking. He's up and walking. Can you just tell us, what are the neeps? Explain the neeps to us.
The neeps, they are turnips.
Turnips?
Yes, they go with the haggis, you know.
Oh,
and you know what a haggis is?
Oh, look, we've heard a lot of rumours.
A wee beastie. Yeah.
And what do they do to it?
They boil it.
Right, OK. Mm-hmm. You boil everything up here, don't you?
More you can't resist boiling.
No.
You're off to boil something now, aren't you?
What are neeps?
Turnips.
Turnips.
Turnips. Yeah.
I see. What a tatties would be. Potatoes. Do you do that to everything, do you? If
no.
I've got to say a cigarette, would that be a retty?
No.
Fag, that would be.
Fag. That's something entirely different in Australia. Neeps, are you into the neeps?
Oh, no, not the neeps and the tatties.
What are they up to? Why are they just...
I've no idea.
Why are they shortening every word?
No idea. Scotland.
Scotland, yeah, not Landy, as I call
this it. This isn't going out in Scotland, is it?
You know, it's been quite a while since Oliver Stone had any movies out. You probably wonder what he's been up to. Have a look. Sir, you are the man behind Oliver Stone hairdressing?
Yes, I am.
Are you Oliver Stone yourself?
No, I'm not Oliver Stone.
Your name is?
Tom Liddell.
Tom Liddell?
Yes.
And what do you have in common with, of course, the famous drug-gobbling filmmaker?
What in common? Well, both enjoy films.
Do you get people coming in going, I normally go to Martin Scorsese's, but I couldn't get an appointment?
It's a good one. Haven't heard that one before.
You haven't heard that one? No, you get people sitting in the chair and saying, I want my hair back and to the right. Back to the right. Do you get people going... I want you coming in with a Scottish accent and going, I want you to restore my hair to its natural blonde colours.
Ah.
That's really my cue to leave, isn't it? Sorry about that. Every time I ask someone in the street where I can get something to drink, they say, why don't you try the Firkin Off licence? Sorry? The Firkin Off licence? Well, I finally found out what they're on about. Have a look at that. Here's the festival's winner for the best impression of Jamoan. Get a shot of this, Roo. Look at that bloke. Did you ever find yourself just covered in cabbage leaves?
Oh, Tony Martin, well done, Owen! We've got the whole ensemble there! What's going on there? Are you guys off to see the wizard? What the hell is going on? What a motley crew! Well, good to see you.
No,
your end for the Aussies abroad.
Absolutely, and we've just got one message to everyone in Australia. Please send food.
Guys, we thank you once again for your time out of your precious schedules. Go nuts. I think you're over there for one more week, aren't you?
Yes, we are indeed.
All right, I want some nude action this week.
I'm going to be putting on a pirate costume for next week's show. More details to follow.
All right, fantastic. Get home safe.
I'm off to the birthplace of...
Who?
I'm off to the birthplace of Robert Louis Stevenson.
All right, I don't think he'll be there
and
somehow.
What I'm trying to do is build a really nice, awkward ending to this piece. So
hey, mission accomplished. Hey, Tony. I have to go anyway, guys, because Bobby's sitting here and I think I have to do one of those weird-ass live bits. So I'll have to leave you there in Edinburgh. Bugger me! Bobby's turned up! Bob, I feel obliged to ask, since you're here now, how's your week been?
Well, it's quite a heartwarming incident. In the middle of the week, Mickey, I was out and about driving in my car and I'd stopped at a set of traffic lights and I noticed that there was a Hell's Angel beside me.
Wow! How'd he gotten into the car without you noticing him?
No, I mean, he was beside me on the road.
I gotcha. I'm with you now. Right.
Strange thing was...
Right. Yeah. Strange thing was
he wasn't on a motorbike. Mm. He was just standing there in the road and the cars were all backed up behind him.
Well, I suppose being a Hell's Angel, he can pretty much do what he likes.
Well, Hell's Angels aren't above the law, Mickey. I think it's great that boys are out joining clubs and getting a lot of fresh air, but there are still rules.
Okay. Point taken, Bob. Please continue with your story.
Well, this fellow beside me at the lights was a member of the... a bikey gang called the Vigilantes.
Uh-huh.
But I noticed that he had spelt Vigilantes wrong on the back of his jacket.
Right.
So I've wound down my window and I've pointed out his mistake to him.
Okay, well, he must have been grateful for that.
Do you know, Mick, right there and then, in the middle of the road, he invited me along to a Hell's Angels party next week to point out the mistake to the rest of the gang.
Well, let's hope they spell your name right on your gravestone, Bobby. You know, I think it's your. He's right next to me, but I still feel like we're on delay. I still feel like there's a satellite involved.
I've still got my earpiece in.
I still have two. Come in, Bob Franklin. Are you there?
But seriously. Joining a bikie gang is no reason to let your education slip.
And so, do you want to mention the invitation, or?
Well, Mick, perhaps it's time now for an invitation to look inside.
An invitation of a different kind.
An invitation of a different kind. Yeah. An invitation to look inside Bob's scrapbook.
Thank God.
Sleeping. Is this a bad time?
Last night, one more night without sleeping.
Looks great, guys. Yeah. Okay, we might go for a take now. So, Helen, if you just give me a couple of beats after action, that'd be fantastic.
No worries.
Okay. Looks really good, mate. Well done.
Scene 8, Gail and Ben break up. Take 1.
Brian.
Action.
I just think that we need to take like a little break. Gary, would you tell me what's going on? And he said, well, you tell me what's going on. I said, don't you come to me with the you tell me. It's a different story when you're out every
okay,
night, every
we'll
night.
There. There's the footy. We'll cut there. Looks good, guys. Good, yeah. Yeah. Good energy. Well done. Sorry, I've forgotten your name.
Carol,
how are you going?
Good. Who are you again?
I'm Ted.
Ted. That's right. I keep getting you mixed up with Kevin.
Right.
Because I worked with Kevin on Blue Heelers.
Excellent. Mm. Okay, what you're doing, Carol, is great.
Great.
But I just wonder if you could mouth that conversation sort of like the way we did it in rehearsal.
Sure,
yep.
Sure.
Okay.
I just thought that Helen could turn around and ask me to be quiet because that sometimes happens in cafes.
Yeah, it does. Mm. But I think probably the best way to do this scene is to play it just as it is on the page. Yeah?
All right.
Okay.
I don't know, I just think it seems a little bit unreal to me.
Why
like
don't we
that?
Give it a go anyway?
All right.
We'll give it a go.
Ted, you're the director.
Thank you very much, Carol.
Scene 8, Gail and Ben break up, take 2.
Fine.
Action.
I just think that we need to take a little break, that's all I'm saying.
No, I think we both know what you're saying and that's that it's over.
I'm not saying that at all. I'm just saying that I think we need to have a bit of space.
Goodbye, Gail.
Ben.
Goodbye, Gail.
Ben.
Gail, goodbye.
Ben, go.
Okay, cut.
That was good for me, Ted.
What's that secret you're keeping?
Who's taking who for a walk here, then? Oh!
It's a tough old run for Pleasant Ian Plumpton, isn't it?
He never learns, does he?
He never learns. He's always back for more. Bob, thanks for dropping by. You've been a beaut sport. And should we off? Yeah, we're going to take a quick break and be back with more in just a minute. Don't go away.
What is your phone?
I'll be here for the festival. We're just interviewing people on the street about the sexiest man of the century poll. Sean Connery. Who's this bloke over here on the rollerblades?
I'm not a lad there. I'm a lassie.
Oh, pardon me. We're from Australia.
Dave O'Neill's joined us on the couch. Dave, just before we get into it...
Sure.
..I feel it's time for one last important safety message.
See you later. I'm going down to the club.
Just going to put on my fancy pants.
Ted, you're better for you. So maybe you shouldn't be changing those pants right now. What do you reckon?
I'm all right.
Look, mate, I'll change them for you.
Don't worry about it.
You shouldn't be changing, mate.
It's okay. Hey, Joey.
What?
What's this?
Hey, cut it out! Cut it out! Woo! Pull him up! Pull him up now!
If you drink, then change. You're a bloody idiot.
You're watching. Why aren't you all watching? You're prime candidates, you lot. Prime candidates. Hello.
How are
you? You managed to get both legs on properly tonight, Dave,
yes,
I see.
Yes, yes, I've got professional help in that area.
You do? That's good.
Now, Mick, speaking of fancy pants, I went out nightclubbing with my dad this week.
Sorry, I'll have to stop you there. You went out nightclubbing with your dad, you say?
Yeah. Well, he's just retired from the Air Force, okay. And he wanted to spend some time with me. So I said, come out nightclubbing, you know, we'll see how we go.
Okay.
But I not only did I have to teach him the lingo of the street, I also had to get him some new clothes. So have a look at our little adventure here. Okay, everyone, this is my dad. Dad, we're going to go nightclubbing. We've got to get you some new clothes. Let's go. General pants.
Okay,
Mofos,
okay.
Right. Mofos, want to go and have a jiggy to a zig.
Yeah.
Okay, this is a good joint, Dad. Right. Yeah. Party on. Right, okay. Hang on, mate, what's on tonight?
Yeah, we've got a uni night on tonight. You got some
idea
on you?
Yeah.
ID?
Yeah, ID, mate.
What's that?
Jeez, mate, this says you're 20.
Yeah, he's got an ageing disease.
Sorry, mate, Joe's is the other way.
But we're cool moves and we just want to have a jiggy.
Sorry, mate.
Jeez, Dad, you shouldn't have used a fake ID. Yeah. Excuse me, guys. Excuse me. Sorry. It's a special guest. Special guest members. Yeah. Hey.
What's the hurry?
Oh, we just want to go and have a bit of a dance, you know? Yeah, bring me dad out.
No, guys, just top yourself out here, please.
Oh, come on, mate. We just want to have a bit of a dance with my dad and that.
I can't help us. Grab a granny's tomorrow night, mate. There, just pop yourselves in.
Listen, mate, I spent 30 years fighting for this.
Jeez. Don't go in here, mate. They'll let you in. I've been to the joint, Dad. 4 months. Hey, how you going? We just want to come and have a bit of a dance.
Sorry, guys, not tonight.
Oh?
We're cool dudes, and we just want to have a jiggy.
Sorry, not tonight.
Oh, come on!
Listen, dude, you're dissing us, and I'm going to cut you with a blade, you mother.
Listen,
jeez, Dad, no need for violence. Not like a man. Okay, Dad, this is our last chance to build his arms.
Right, eh? We tried it your way, now we're going to try it mine.
Yeah, right. Dad, what are you doing?
Well, 30 years in the Air Force taught me something.
Right. What night is it?
Sorry, mate, it's queer and alternative night.
Queer and alternative? Dad! Dad, people with different lifestyles. Dad, what the hell's going on? Where are you going?
Dave, it's the uniform. Gets them every time.
The uniform? Are you ready for me? What am I going to tell Mum?
She's asleep.
Well. Who are we here? How are you, Kev?
Good on you, Mick.
Thanks for dropping by. Now, that seemed like a wild night out in the town. You do that often, you two?
Yeah, about once a month.
About once a month. Kev, can you prove to us in some way you are actually Dave's dad? Because there's been some conjecture. We all reckon he might have picked you out of the showcast book at the office.
You saw his acting.
Oh.
I think John Wood's pretty safe, you know what I'm saying?
I need to ask you a few questions. Can you tell us about Dave's... Well, we got you here. Just thought it might be... Might be I'll have a couple of interesting insights for us, Dave.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Can you take us back in time? Can you remember his first girlfriend?
Yeah, Sue.
No, it was Philip.
Philip? Philip. It's obviously a bit of a family joke there. Someone will explain it to me a little later. What was his first car?
An orange Tirana, which, I spent more time underneath it than behind the wheel, but anyway.
Underneath it, fixing it.
Yeah.
Dave wasn't actually a mechanic as a young boy?
No.
What did you hope for him to be when he grew up?
Well, I thought he might have been a phys ed teacher or something like that. Probably a football or something.
Yeah, football?
I did play some sport, you know.
What sport did you play?
BMX riding, mate.
You, mate, yeah. The BMX bike, you would have crushed that bike like an ant.
No, not at all. Dad brought me the trophy along, didn't
you? Oh, yes, yeah. Well, you brought this along, Mick. It's the BMX Oscar.
And what was that awarded for?
Third place, mate. In the amateur stakes.
Third place. But do you have any other evidence that can support this?
Mate, Dad failed to bring along this one, though. Check this out.
What the hell is it?
I actually bought this one, so...
I saw a couple of panel beaters working on that out the back just before. So there you go. And did you bring it a photo?
Dad, you bring the photo?
Oh, yes, we've got the photo there.
Yeah, they've got upstairs. There I am.
Action man. Why isn't BMXing an Olympic sport? That's done in countries all over the world.
I know. Mm. It's a shame, isn't it? Yeah. It's a real shame. I could get back on the bike, I reckon. I actually got back on the bike the other day. I rode past one of those mirrored office blocks. I look like a pumpkin riding a mosquito.
And Kev, was he a naughty boy? Did you have to punish him a lot?
No, not much punishment.
You didn't punish him?
No.
You must have done something just for your own amusement.
Well, you know what I mean? I think the only time we had problems when we had the bomb squad around, but...
You had the bomb squad around?
Yeah, you have to talk about that.
What happened there?
Well, we had a visit from this nice policeman, and he said, how are you going, Darren? You know, he's one of our ex-scouts, and... I said to him, how are things going? He said, well, we've got a bit of a problem here. We've got Mr. Blast from the explosives department. Mm. And he said, do you recognise any of these? And I said, what? And he lifted up the bonnet of his car and he had all these mangled oil cans there.
Oh, yes.
He said, do you recognise them? I said, oh, look familiar. He said, check the garage. I said, yeah. He said, what else is missing? He said, any chlorine or...
Dad, don't tell them how to make them. They want your current affair for that.
Did you bring in a fact sheet, Kev? Yeah.
That's what the internet's for, Dad. Yeah.
Wasn't around in your day, didn't have that day.
Yeah, so basically Dad got us arrested and we had to go to the police station because we were making bombs in the paddock.
Yeah.
I mean, I was, what, 23 at the time?
Yeah.
Well, you're a military man, I know that. You've been in the Air Force for some time and I'm sure you would have punished him appropriately. Maybe we could continue it during the ad break, which we have to go to now. So thanks for dropping by, Kev. You're a good sport. And I tell you what, the boys look pretty comfy on the couch over here, don't they? We might have to have father-son night on here very soon. Hesse, you're looking worried. All right, we're off to the break. We'll see you in a second.
One,
cheers.
Two.
So I tap this guy on the shoulder, he's turned round, and it's me. I'm looking in my own face. Except he's got bright yellow eyes. Whoa, drink up, boys, we're on.
There's something for Barry to practice with his double bass. Write that down as something to do this week, Barry. Oh, hello. Kev's just slipped in like a dream, hasn't he? No one told Kev about this before the show.
It's amazing what my dad will do for $80 cash.
It's $80.
We gave you $150. You're cutting your dad away.
I'm his agent.
What kind of creepy son are you?
Oh, he doesn't need the money. There we are.
Bob, I don't know what's going on, but I'm presuming you have something to do with this.
Mickey, we've all had a warm bath.
Not together.
Yes. Speak for yourself, Kev. Our pipes are stoked up. We've cravatted up. We've all got cucumber sandwiches. Kev, tuck in.
Don't be shy, Kev.
Go for your life.
Oh,
it's a bit of light supper. Because it's time for... How delightful.
G'day, mate. I was just wondering if I might be able to have a look at one of those stereos in the back there. Maybe I'll come back when you're not so busy.
How delightful.
Well, that was just,
just... Hey, Kev, you're pulling too hard on the pipe there, son. What's going? What's going on?
No, I must say your father's pipe smells a bit funny.
In fact, let's all have a honk onto Kev's pipe, shall we?
Don't bogart your pipe. Ken, pass it around.
I think it's a bit of your grass, eh?
You know, it's... I like...
You told me there were tomato plants in the backyard.
Keep it later, boys, later. I love how elaborate this whole thing is getting. It started with the cucumber sandwiches. And look at us now.
Look at it.
We're going
kind of elaborate. Hesse, I think you're required to do some kind of playoff.
Well, then I'll...
Right now. But can you do it in the apron?
I will.
And with a pie?
With attitude?
I want plenty of attitude.
All right, attitude coming up, sir.
And take a scone.
All right, boys, I think we'll play Nice Lady.
That was a hell of a shot, bro.
Nice Lady goes like this, Ken. 2, 3, 4.
And Patchy's joined us on the couch. How are you, Patchy?
Very well, thanks, Mick.
I'm going out a limb here, but I'm suggesting we're about to get some entertainment news.
We certainly are. Whenever Hollywood's running short of ideas, they go for either remakes or sequels.
Sure.
And there's been a bit of news in that department this week. First of all, there's going to be a Back to the Future 4 and a Mad Max 4.
Wow.
Both coming out next year. And I don't want to be a motion picture party pooper, but I think both Mel Gibson and Michael J. Fox are both going to cark it at the end of those films.
At the end of the 4, so it's going to end at 4.
Mm-hmm.
Until he's reborn or something dodgy goes on. And...
That's as far as it goes.
Okay.
And there's been a bit of conjecture about... there's a remake of Charlie's Angels, and it's going to have Drew Barrymore and Cameron Diaz filling the first two spots.
Mm-hmm.
But there's been a lot of talk about who's going to fill the third spot, and the latest rumour is Posh Spice, or Victoria Adams, is going to fill that third slot.
Crikey. Well, there you go.
Can you wait?
I can't wait. Don't come on and tease me like that. When does it open?
Well, I think we're talking late next year.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Looking good.
But I've been tipped onto a great bit of footage this week, and we really should take a look at this. It's from a video called Isn't That What's-His-Name? It's from the National Film and Sound Archive. And,
oh, yeah.
You know, there's been a lot of disturbing footage involving Pete Smith over the last few weeks about the dark side of him in real life. But this dark side does extend to his professional personality. Let's take a look at this.
Mm-hmm. Specials all week at your Safeway fruit and veggie market.
My voice broke on one bit, I didn't like it.
Was it slow? How slow? Oh, okay. It's still a problem to hold that together like that. Then when I snap, that part is there, that low in my hand. I've got to do that. You follow what I'm saying? You know what I'm... Well, I'll try and get it up. Yeah, all right. Hey, and don't forget to try your dog on Thrifty Buy. Only 39 cents and the bloody sign's fallen down. You would think that. Because I can't look, Simon, that's all. I can't see. Well, this week the Red Spot specials keep coming down to ridiculous prices. Ridiculous because they're so low. Now, look, here's what I mean. 700 gram cans come in. We're only recording.
Making of Apocalypse Now, isn't it? It's amazing they didn't all go mad.
Before the invention of Blue Tack, obviously, too.
That was some unwinding, Pete, up. And what's the name of that video? That's from the Film and Sound Archive.
Yeah, it's called Isn't That What's-His-Name. Yeah.
Oh, all right, well, get yourself a copy of that. Sounds like loads of fun.
Beef and Eitley.
Now, have you guys been to see a film this week or no?
We went in separate cars, separate cinemas.
Yeah. But what's going on?
I don't know. He's left me. I don't know. We did. We went and saw Go.
That's right. Yeah, that's the new film from the American director Doug Liman, who made Swingers, one of the best films from last year.
Mm-hmm.
There's been a lot of hype about this film, and I won't say it's an absolute classic, but it's still a pretty good film.
Yeah?
How would you tell the story of this film? It's a bit hard to explain.
Well, look, mate, it's about the passage of youth. It's about like...
Sorry. Could you look any more comfortable?
Oh, now the passage of youth.
I'm starting to blush over here.
I actually went into a shop and some guy said, did I see you horizontal on television the other night? He said I was horizontal as opposed to vertical. But anyway, moving on. Have you got that panic button ready? Go is basically about kids growing up, going to rave parties, taking drugs. It's basically like our youth, except in our youth there were no drugs, no rave parties, just blue light discos. It's basically like that.
But it kind of follows three different people on the same big night out, and it keeps going back to the one point in time just to see what they're doing. But there's the one bit of vision we have got is of this this young lad who's taken a mind-altering substance and finds himself in the company of a telepathic cat.
Crikey.
Mm. Let me just, fill out a return slip here, and I'll have the manager give you a refund.
Todd, I'm trying to explain to you what happened. All right, they already got the stuff from somewhere else, right? It was a case of miscommunication. I mean...
Yeah, but that's happened to all of us at some stage. You know what I mean? How's that worthy of being made a film? What do you think of the film?
Yeah, it's not an absolute classic, but it's still a dead set 7 out of 10.
No 7 out of 10, good value, good entertainment value. Dave?
I'd say 9 out of 10. And look how nice and straight I'm sitting now, Mick.
And how were the lollies?
The lollies were shit house, but let's not go into that. We don't have half an hour. Yeah.
Hey, there's another clip from the film I'd like to show. So,
yeah, this is the car chase scene. This is where all the characters kind of perish in a kind of a fiery wreck. Let's take a look at this.
Yeah, let's take a look at that right now. Hang on a second. That's slightly gratuitous. What's going on upstairs? Sorry, that wasn't... That's from...
That was one of the outtakes, obviously.
Can we have a look at that clip from Go, please?
Oh, what is going on?
There's something going on upstairs.
Yes.
I know it as a fact. Just wait here. I'll sort this out. Just hold on one second. Idiots. Cannot believe it. Absolute fools. Adrian. Oh, not this again. I might have known.
Remove your clothes.
Steady on, Adrian. What's up with you all of a sudden?
Take off your clothes.
Jesus, you're fruity.
Or we shall do it for you.
Right, eh? Follow your horses. Right.
Put your clothes back on. Immediately.
I see. Everyone's a funny man all of a sudden. And as for you, how is that piano going to take to tune?
Hours.
What do we do now?
Cut to a commercial break.
Oh, okay. Since you asked so nicely. We're booting this baby home right now. We're getting out a little earlier tonight. Had a power hour with the network during the week and decided an hour and a half was our fill. So we're doing that. And you may have noticed Pendo not on board tonight because he's, as we speak, at Perisher in the snowfields following a report. So we look forward to seeing that next week.
I'm clearing up all the business at this time of the night. You don't mind, do you? No. Something for Kate. We had them on earlier. Sensational. We've got some tour dates here. Can we throw those up? Coming to a town near you very soon. Check them out. That was good gear tonight, I thought. Now, here's their new CD, Beautiful Sharks. Can we get a close-up of that somehow? That's an absolute cracker. So give that a bill. I'd like to thank Kathy Lett for dropping by, and she'll be appearing. Yeah, she was great. Give her a round. She'll be appearing tomorrow in a forum at the Malthouse Theatre for the Melbourne Writers' Festival. So go along and see if anyone else can get a word in. And...
My dad's got a couple of dates too.
Where's your dad appearing?
My dad's on at the Mitcham Scout Hall. He'll be stacking the bottles up in the back there.
All right. All right. And before we go, we've got a very special guest to go out with the band tonight. It's Stephen Cummings. Welcome aboard, Stephen. How are you, bro?
Good.
Good to see you, buddy. And I should mention Stephen's new CD, Spiritual Bum. That was a late night naming session, wasn't it, Stephen?
It
kind of went on for a while and you went, bugger it, I'll settle for Spiritual Bum. What have you guys got worked out for us tonight, Hesse? What are you sitting on? How are you taking us out tonight?
It's all love and it's Stephen. Don't talk about love, talk about, don't talk about love.
That sounds fantastic. And I should say, have you got a novel out too, Stephen?
I have, yes.
What's the deal?
It's called Stay Away From Lightning Girl.
Are you part of Melbourne Writers Week?
No, not this year, last year.
Last year? Yeah. Well, good for you. Sounds like a great read anyway. Thank you one and all for being part of the show tonight. And Hesse booted home in the usual fashion. Take it away, boys.
Talk to me about